Welcome back to the show that never ends every Tuesday, Torchfork Tuesday. I am your host. You should know me by now, so I'm not going to bother. Thank you for joining us. You are just jumping in at the tail end of watching Caitlin play yet more Zelda, and we're going to get into that in a second. But first, she has to eat some much-needed sustenance, because at this point, she pretty much only lives to stream. That being said, I do want to take a few minutes and celebrate the fact that our fearless leader has finally touched down in his destination of choice. Chris Kellogg has been gone for a bit. He has joined us again. He finally got his desktop set up.
Dude, I'm in my, once again, in my childhood bedroom, because the apartment I'm moving into does not have a floor. So, working on the floor, and then I'll be able to move in.
Those are necessary for walking.
Can I just applaud you, sir, for being so comfortable in a geography class?
Yes, there'll be a quiz at the end, and you have to sing it just the way they did on the Animaniacs.
Didn't I make a reference to that earlier? But you need to get a look for that.
And I just watched that episode like 2 days ago while I was packing, and it was excellent.
So what we need to do in between games, you're going to have to just do, it's like the poker rap. You're going to have to do at least 10 at a shot.
Mm-hmm. And you have to sing it like a member of the Beatles, just the way they did in the anime.
Exactly. And you need not the Pokemon Go rap, which is only two friggin' Pokemon. But that being said, we'll all take shots while you try and remember all the countries. And that being said, moving on. Of course, we already talked about Caitlin. She has been streaming through Zelda like there's no tomorrow, because who knows, there might not be. And judging from this election. But Caitlin, you've been having fun with Zelda Ocarina of Time. How is it?
Oh my gosh. See, this whole last week, I wanted to play it. I wanted to play it really bad, and then I met the Shadow Temple.
So the Water Temple didn't faze you, but you got
not
stuck
at all. Well, the Water Temple
no,
was tranquil
that's, don't
and
say it.
Calm.
Do not say it didn't faze you. You raged a couple times. I was there.
We have the videotape. We have the video.
We have the footage.
Shadow Temple, if you do levels of rage,
no, but I agree.
Did the Fire Temple?
I agree.
Then I calmed down for the Water Temple, and then my stress level is like up to 11 for Shadow Temple because of all the holes.
Well, you know, they're holes. But what about the hands that come from the ceiling?
Yes, this is the sequel to my hatred for that one level in Link to the Past with the invisible floor. That thing took me like 2.5 hours, I swear, where they wanted me to do a blooper reel because of how many times I fell on the gosh darn invisible floor. And it happened in Shadow Temple. Again, I have PTSD.
Okay.
From Zelda.
From Zelda.
It's intense. Those tights get tight.
It'll do that, though.
Holes. Too many holes. I don't know.
Too many holes is not a thing that
I'm just
you can
gonna
honestly
let that
say
hang.
Too often. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, that's all I'm gonna say. That's something you can't say too often, and it makes like a lot of sense. There's too many holes.
Too many holes.
It's, you know, the phrase in the Navy. You know, there is no wrong hole. So there's that.
I don't know why my mic got muted there.
I don't know, but it's great that we even have video. Eli, the master, the grand meister of the game show.
And a sweet background.
And a sweet, sweet background. He's coming to us from the other International Space Station.
Yeah, it's called the Constellation. But
it's the moon.
But I was trying to say, Dreamy Warrior, do I need to do my fan dance and seduce you to prove that I'm really me?
Yes. Make sure you're leveled up.
Is that what I need to do?
Make sure you're leveled
I think
up.
Because my fan dance is amazing.
After playing enough Final Fantasy, I beating Final Fantasy VI this week, I feel I can say that. Make sure you're leveled up enough.
And don't forget to say
leveled up for the fan dance? Mm-hmm. You really feel
I leveled up my fan dance specifically for this purpose.
Eli gets it.
See, this is why people keep coming back to the show. They level up, they come, they do their fan dance. Well, we haven't hit, like,
do their fan dance.
We have to wait about an hour or two for all the, like, kids to go to sleep. Oh, wait, Man Bear's in the chat, so we can totally do it anyway. And finally, the only reason Square Enix even is important to the Torchfork team, Rob Kelly.
Oh, okay. That's where that was going.
I was thinking about going a different direction, but I said, nah, screw it. He has been marathoning Final Fantasy for the last couple of weeks, even.
I just beat it. I'm on to Mario RPG now.
Yeah. Were you planning on beating it at that point?
Caitlin's question first. It is a turn-based Mario RPG. It's similar to, like, it's what made, like, the Paper Mario and the Mario and Luigi games. Mm-hmm. But it's really fun. You get, like, Peach and Bowser on your team, and you, like, level up, kind of like Final Fantasy. You kill enemies, you get experience, money.
Who's the villain if you have Bowser on your team?
Smithy. It explains it in the game. Like, literally, the beginning of the game is explaining it.
Yeah, well, and Bowser starts as your enemy, kind of, at the very beginning.
You think it's going to be an atypical Mario game, and all of a sudden, what? Sword in the castle, which is not...
Bowser gets evicted.
Yeah, that's it. Bowser gets evicted to his own castle.
Oh, and spoilers.
The graphics are unbelievable. I think among the best graphics for Super Nintendo.
It is. It was one of the last games to come out for Super Nintendo, so they were kind of like pushing the 3D graphic aspect of it. And on top of that, I actually owned I own a complete in-box Japanese version of the game, too. Because why not? That's it.
And there were a lot of throwbacks to popular culture. There were even some Final Fantasy throwbacks in the game as well.
Yep, you can fight one of the bosses from Final Fantasy IV in it, which is pretty cool. He's like a secret boss at the end of the game.
Which is weird, because you only need, what, the stone for the door?
Yeah, you need the shiny stone, but there's like just like getting the big Goron sword in Zelda, there's like a small little, what do you call it? Not scavenger hunt, but... Oh man, you know, you get one item, you go give it to a person, they give you another, you go give another person that same item that you just got.
Scavenger hunt, sort of.
Yeah, exactly. Scavenger hunt-esque, and you get the, like, best weapons in the game and whatnot, and the shiny stone, which gets you into the room in Monstro Town. I'm gonna do all that eventually.
Eventually. You gotta find the casino, though. That was always my favorite part.
Yep.
But that being said, speaking of gambling, great segue. No, not really. So what is this show all about? We take a bunch of games that are releasing or have been releasing or are going to be releasing from all walks of life, from all platforms, although we tend to stick with Steam Greenlight because, God almighty, there's such great things there, and not even half of them are good. Of course, I do want to take a few moments to talk about, hey, Digital Homicide did a fucked up thing, and they're disappearing now from Steam Greenlight.
Yeah, they're going to be, Digital Homicide, the company, is going to be gone themselves. They're pulling the suit, and they're out of money. They're just done.
Yeah, I can't imagine, you know, it seemed like a great idea on paper to sue Valve.
Yeah.
That seemed like it was going to go places, but... So, you know, let this be a lesson. If you're a developer, don't sue people for saying you make shitty games when you make shitty games.
Or you allowed people to make shitty games for your company.
Yeah.
There you go.
Also, don't represent yourself in court.
Like, yes.
At all.
Yeah, goddamn Ted Bundy.
Yeah, that always...
Who got that joke?
I got it. I just don't want it anymore. Anyway, so the point of this show, I'm going to send the list not to you people, but to the people on the chat. Not the chat, this chat, us chat. And we're going to go through and we're just going to give our thoughts about what we see. Some of them might be good. Some of them might be shit. Some of them might have to do with VR. Maybe. We missed you, Chris. We had a VR game. You weren't here.
I wish I could have been there. I had to do some final closing ceremonies in Nashville, but I'm sure I will be back. I'm sure I'll get another chance to champion the VR cause.
Did you
hear about what the VR game was last week?
I did not. I missed it. What is it?
It was an amazing thing that you really should have been there to see. They put a visual novel in VR.
Oh my god.
Was it made by
two people, both of which are graphic designers?
Possibly.
No, they actually needed a team of 17 people and a Kickstarter.
You know, it's not that hard to make a VR game, actually. My friend made one who has zero gaming programming knowledge. He's just, you know, kind of good with computers and good at math. He made a demo in Unity that worked in the DK2, and it only took him a week.
Way to talk him up there, Chris.
I just, you know, for a guy that doesn't know anything about building video games, he made a pretty good VR demo. That's all I'm going to say.
That's fair.
So why does it take 17 people to make a walking simulator?
I don't know.
Not even a walking simulator. A visual novel where you read.
Yeah, if you look up, you can see the
page. Do you know how hard it is to read things in VR? It's, like, impossible. Like,
yeah, we saw from the trailer.
Yeah. No, it really is. One of my biggest gripes about Elite Dangerous is that the text is too small. And it doesn't work well in VR. You can't read the screen.
That was the one thing that I hated when I was playing Elite on Oculus. It was just like trying to figure out what the hell I was selecting on the screens because everything looked like blocky little blobs.
Yeah, it's, and it's better on the Vive because it's a higher resolution screen, but it still has the same problem, ultimately. Mm-hmm. And the thing is, in VR, it's like, They could make the letters three times your height. That would be interesting.
But then they wouldn't be able to fit it all.
Yeah, but at least it would be different than a graphic novel.
You would think, but who knows? Maybe we'll find something equally as terrible and atrocious on this list.
I'm not a game developer, folks.
Maybe you should be. But then everything would be VR and Nintendo related. So we're going to get right into it. The first game on this list, and I'm always going to read the notes because I love them. They come from Stylomax. I feel like he's the unsung hero, or Eli for that matter. But I can tell Stylos because it's always a yet another space sim for Steven. So, with that in mind, the first game is Butcher, releasing October 5th. And the notes are, reminds me of an old Worms knockoff I used to play.
That was my comment.
These sounds like... These almost sound like Jeopardy categories. Almost.
Almost.
That's true.
I love that you made your own description. I feel like we've been missing that.
We have.
Well, I have to admit that the pixel art is already pretty cool in this trailer.
Yeah, so I'm really that out there. And I spent all of yesterday watching a friend do a pixel art, like pixel by pixel, and I'm just sitting here like, this is pretty cool.
I gotta say, I like a lot of this already, although it's not still entirely clear what's occurring.
It looks really... Is it supposed to look super zoomed in?
Yeah, I think, Stylo, I think you might just be grabbing, like, a portion of it, unless I'm mistaken.
Yeah, that's totally what's going on.
It just looks like...
Oh, he probably just has the window.
Oh, okay, he's fixing it. He's fixing it.
Oh, I was hoping he was going to keep. But anyway, it looks a lot more
that's
like...
That's the entire point of the trailer. That's all we needed to see.
Oh, you know what it reminds me of? It reminds me of the old...
The law.
It reminds me of Alien 3 for the Genesis. Because you're basically running around a maze, you're shooting stuff.
I need to get that game.
You really should, but I really like this. I normally write this kind of off as, oh, yet another pixel game or another pixel shooter, but this looks fun. I mean, when it's not zoomed in. I mean, zoomed in is fun too.
I think we're starting to get a little more of it now, though.
Yeah, there we go. Here we go. Nice.
Murder.
Yeah.
Murder. Oh, it looks even better far away.
Oh yeah. Oh, I definitely played this. All right.
Mm-hmm.
Rapid skill-based carnage. Those are phrases I like.
What? Which part? Skill based or rapid?
No, the whole thing. Rapid skill based carnage is like kind of the embodiment of what I love most in video games.
Carnage just reminds me of like Spider-Man.
Yeah, I also usually think of Spider-Man when I think of carnage. Or if
that
someone
explains
suspended.
All the red in the swinging things.
You know what's interesting is after having played through Super Metroid, I'm starting to feel like there's some elements here. Like you see that part where like he's in like the cavernous area and the lava rises. Not that that's a bad thing, not at all. It's just you can tell there's Butcher. You can tell that this is definitely inspired by some of the best action side scrollers.
I know this is added to my wish list, and
the easiest mode.
I hope it's
is
cheap.
Hard. It was awesome.
I can't see anything really wrong with it. It apparently won a couple of awards. Ooh. But I'm definitely looking.
John Romero of Doom commented on the game personally.
Just personally? And what did he say, personally?
He said, hardcore!
I really don't think John Romero knows how to speak in anything other than buzzwords, though, so...
Yeah, that's probably true, but I mean, this crap made Doom 3 awesome. With the exception of Doom 3.
Yeah, we're not gonna talk about that one. So, any final thoughts? I think we've seen everything we need to see.
Play the crap out of this, looks great.
I
just wish I could remember the game that I was thinking of It was clone of Worms, but it was way faster paced. There was a lot of stuff with you like flying around the screen, just shooting streams of bullets. It was a long time ago.
Oh, wow.
A long time ago. Do not remember what it was called, and I feel bad for that.
He'll figure it out, and he'll shout. He'll just blurt it out.
I probably won't, because I think I played it when I was like 14.
Oh, well.
A long time ago.
Well, we're going to move on to the next one. A lot of drinks ago, too. The next game is called Sentry Knight Tactics. It releases on today. And it's an RPG strategy game with a cute art style. Different look than most other strategy games I've seen. A cute art style.
Aww!
Like the opposite of obtuse.
Well,
are those Golbats?
There's Caitlin's squeal of approval.
There's blood, I'm convinced.
I want to be the bat, unless you have to fight the bat. But I want to be the bat.
I think you have to fight the bat.
That's the other indie game. I want to be the bat.
So this is kind of like a simplified version of Castle Crashers.
Yeah.
Yep.
Like mobile version.
A simplified like beat 'em up. It looks like it looks fun. Like in all honesty, I actually think the style is pretty.
Who said Brawlhalla? Because I totally agree.
Isn't Brawlhalla a fighting game?
Not quite.
This just makes me.
I said beat 'em up.
I want stickers of all the characters. Just put on my.
Well, the only reason why I say Brawlhalla is because it's another 2D fighting game. I guess it's about as far as it goes, but it seems to be some. It's funny how the 2D fighting games seem to be making this like weird little comeback.
This isn't a fighting game. True. This looks like a weird RPG sort of deal.
This is more like a side scrolling. Castle Crashers, Chris.
Okay, I'm sorry. I just didn't interpret very well what I was seeing, obviously.
Now, if you want to say Chibi Golden Axe, might be closer.
It's only $9 and pretty much has only gotten positive reviews so far.
For $9, I'd say that's pretty good.
Oh, it's on sale.
I guess that depends on how much you can get Castle Crashers for.
I'd play both.
You save a whopping $1 if you buy it on sale. So, rush over to Steam right now. Save that
Don't
dollar.
Lose your dollar.
Castle Crashers is still 15.
You buy a lot of chocolate for that dollar.
Yep. Wow. But I'm just saying this game, it looks fun.
Okay, so if this is $5 cheaper than Castle Crashers, sure.
Yeah. Well, there you go. If you're too friggin' cheap to buy Castle Crashers, here.
Or if you've beaten Castle Crashers and want to try something new.
Why would you want to try something new? You got Castle Crashers.
Seriously, I like new stuff. New stuff.
Take your glasses off. Play Castle Crashers. Whole new world. You'll be fine.
Good idea.
I thought so. Or just go play Newgrounds games.
You'll have no idea what's even happening.
See? Eli's got the right idea.
Completely new and different world to you.
That's right. So, there's not much else that I guess could be said about this. I think that we could probably get a game or two of this going on the streams, don't you think?
Mm-hmm.
Seems like it'd be fun.
Yeah, I mean, I could see this fitting in nicely next to the, this is, cute, Nintendo's cute, People love to watch this kind of thing, and it's always, I don't know why, but I feel like these types of games just invite a little more, social atmosphere, because it is lighthearted,
There doesn't seem to be multiplayer. Unfortunately.
Well, when I say social, I meant more between our audience and the person playing. Mm-hmm.
I suppose, yeah.
Yeah.
You can just have people drunkenly yelling commands. I don't see why not. We do it all the time.
And it takes virtually nothing to play the game, too, so that's nice.
That's true. It's true.
Didn't you guys command that I build a house today with the saw?
What else are you going to build?
That was me, and that's the secret of the game.
Oh.
Just like the secret of Link making a burrito.
Are you talking about Zelda?
Wow.
Yeah.
They were telling me totally to build a house and make burritos.
Yeah.
You can absolutely
do that.
You build a house and you make some burritos.
Find a cuckoo, just chase it down, whack it a bunch of times, and just make a chicken burrito. That's right. Fine. Try it
There's
out.
There's a Chipotle right underneath Death Mountain. You just
yeah, they like Jack Johnson wrote a song for when like Link's cooking the burrito. And everything.
There's also an El Pollo Loco on the east end.
Oh my gosh, you guys! I can't even tell if you guys are fucking with me or if you're serious. It's random.
It's not an El Pollo Loco. It's actually a Chick-fil-A.
Oh my gosh. It's a weird story. Suddenly, okay, so I was riding my bike by Chick-fil-A yesterday, and they have their employees walk outside with tablets and take people's orders for the drive-thru. Like,
it's brilliant.
That's classy.
It's weird. There's three people standing in the back of Chick-fil-A on the lane with like a tablet, leaning into cars, taking their orders. I'm like, what the hell is this?
Are you sure it wasn't just a bunch of workers that had tablets and were playing?
No, they were actually playing Bejeweled.
Yeah.
They were walking up to cars and saying, "Hi there, there's a ride on in your car. I was wondering if I could catch it."
Sure. Oh, hold on. You're going to have to pause. I just got three in a row. No.
Not to totally derail the conversation, but
just on the Chick-fil-A thing, man, those guys make some damn good food. I know that they are politically not the best, but man, I miss them because in the South, they're everywhere and their food is amazing and they're so nice to you when you go in there. But
yeah, that's just because the CEO is a total dirtbag doesn't mean that every single employee working for them is going to be awful also. I agree, pretty tasty chicken.
Yeah. But I guess go eat elsewhere, folks.
Yeah, I mean, there is always better places, and then sometimes you're lazy and want to play some games. So Chick-fil-A is the faster option.
I can't believe we just pitched Chick-fil-A with such a backhanded compliment. I mean, Popeyes, I understand.
Oh, man. Give me some Popeyes any day. I will eat it and then die after a couple weeks. Get out of here.
You just can't have
it. We're ending this conversation because I don't like it.
I don't like fast food chicken unless it's in nugget form from McDonald's.
So
how does nothing you say makes sense? We're moving on.
That's really funny because to me, when it comes to McDonald's,
guys, this isn't a mukbang. This is a game show.
Grilled chicken sandwich.
It's still a mukbang. See what you missed, Chris. This is what you walked away from.
No.
I need to have King Goldbat from this game. Look at that King Goldbat.
That's not a Goldbat. We're gonna move on.
It's the King Goldbat.
It's neither. The next game is, apparently we're sticking with the Newgrounds theme tonight. The next game is called Ballistick.
I was saying it as Ballistick in my mind.
Ballistick?
Ballistick.
Ballistick.
Okay.
Yeah, this is a fighting simulator. You learn Bali.
You learn ballet.
Maybe it's Bollywood. It's a Bollywood sim. That's exactly
Bomb Shelter Games.
It is, of course, it's coming out on October 14th. And yeah, it's Stick Death.
Oh, this looks like the Stick Figure Death, or not, no, Madness Avenger. That's what it looks like.
There you go.
You never went to Stick Death as a kid, did
you? Oh, Madness. Madness was
I did.
A little
I went to Stick Figure Death Theater all the time as a kid.
Yeah, this is like.
No, Stick Death.
Yeah, just Stick Death.
Right.
Stick Death was a website.
Yeah.
It looks like.
I remember those.
But yeah, I would play this. It also looks a little bit like Madness, yeah. But the Madness characters look different. They weren't stick characters. They were like floating shapes, essentially.
Yeah, that's right. You're right. But this definitely feels inspired by those.
There's also a Madness game, if you did not know.
Yeah, and they're free.
Mm-hmm. They're really cool. They're pretty fun. But yeah, this looks fun. In a very like easy, cheesy way. Didn't mean to rhyme there. Either way.
I gotta say, though, this doesn't look super creative.
No.
No. To me, it looks exactly like Stick Death.
But it's like it's
slightly better drawings.
Yeah, I was about to say, it's definitely feeding like a certain niche.
How do you do a better stick figure, Eli? Exactly.
Well, no, the stick figures look exactly the same as the Stick Death ones. I'm talking about the background art looks a little better than what was on Stick Death.
Yes.
I don't know. Are we sure this isn't an official Stick Death game? Looks pretty
close. Yeah, pretty sure it's not, because they would have had it branded Stick Death if it was. But Stick Death shut down a long time ago, as far as I know.
Check it out.
One can hope that they did. Bye. Any other thoughts on the Stick Death?
It specifically says in the thing, the stick figure days are back. That's great.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, it just, I do, I mean, just to touch on the stick figure sort of.
Did you watch the stick figure flash videos of the 2000s? Are you a fan of Newgrounds and Zao Zao or Stick Death?
Yeah, Zao Zao. I love Zao Zao. Yeah, okay. Yeah. So now this actually made me like it so much more because it's paying direct, like, homage to those guys. So that's awesome. I gave a little more respect for that.
I want to know, I mean, it shouldn't be more than, like, $10, but still.
$39.99 on the Steam store. No, I'm kidding.
They're actually, I know. $79.99 deluxe edition with art book. Either way.
I would buy that.
Figure on a podium.
I do think that for what this is and what they're going for, I think they're doing it right, because I saw all those websites we just discussed. Most of us viewed them and enjoyed them. So they're just kind of like feeding a niche nostalgia. They're not going to sell like a million copies of this game. Hopefully they'll sell like 20,000 to a bunch of people that were like, hey, I remember that stuff being really funny.
you watch and YouTube will be awash with Ballistick videos.
Yeah, I know, really.
And we may be one of them. We don't
know. This is, so far it's been a good night for games. What's going on?
Yeah, well, and it's funny. I feel like we're in this like nice little like, it's like these smaller games that are probably like a ton of fun, but didn't look like they took like too much time to develop. They spent more time on gameplay than the other stuff, you know?
Well,
which is good.
Let's start wrecking that right now, because we have a detective game next. The next game is called Adam Wolfe, and I'm pretty sure I went to school with an Adam Wolfe, but that's another story. It is going to be releasing on the 7th of October.
That wasn't always on. See, real quick, though, that Ballistick game is $5.
$5.
That makes it even more worth it.
Get yourself a stick for $5. I say go.
Yes.
My name is Adam Wolfe.
So, sorry, go ahead.
No, I'm amazed and befuddled and stupefied at the $5 stick. But we're going to move on to Adam Wolfe. Detective novel found thing. Oh, God. I just saw further in the trailer, and I'm sorry. It's a detective-ish game.
Did anyone else see that? Go ahead. Sorry, Chris.
No, sorry. The Steam description isn't finished.
It's not. That's the best part.
It just doesn't finish. It just ends. It was done on purpose.
Yeah, and curses are just some of the things that Adam will come across as he tries to solve a what?
I gotta know! I must buy the game!
Oh, that's insidious.
Oh my god. The motorcycle riding scene.
The motorcycle.
It's, what? It's episodical.
I hope so.
Time was it's gone. Episodical.
Because that would explain a lot.
Adam Wolf is looking a little like Max Payne.
Max Payne, if he was an emo frontman for a band, sure.
This looks like an old Macintosh game, like, you know, the old King's Quest or like Might and Magic 3 back when. It looks like that with just HD skins.
The resolution of the graphics are pretty excellent.
Moving story, but I don't know. It doesn't look
2D art. It's not hard to get.
You can still screw that up.
It's a lot easier to get nice-looking 2D art than it is to get nice-looking 3D art.
And then you add in that motorcycle scene, and God.
Oh yeah, I was just like taken back to 1993.
When you look at the system specs, the recommended ones and the minimum ones are almost identical. DirectX 9 is now kind of my kind of go-to for like, this game's probably not made well now. Like, if you haven't gotten past, I think, DirectX 9, and that's not universally true, but if you haven't gotten past DirectX 9, you are using old shit, and you're probably not good at what you're doing.
And yet there are still going to be some people on Steam that are raging that their Windows 95 machine can't run it. So, what are you going to do?
They're going to be complaining specifically that the developers didn't make it in a way that it would run on their Windows 95 machine. Greater than
even my own. Yeah, and of course, it's always going to be a conspiracy so that you have to upgrade Windows to at least XP. So,
I mean, what?
At least. Minimum. I mean, that's going to be hard for the 0.1% of people still on 98.
Yeah, I think it is.
98 played Diablo 2 very well. Okay, so.
So does a toaster nowadays. Your this point is? Anyway, go ahead. You were going to say a thing.
Me?
No, I was going to say this game doesn't look that interesting to me.
Okay, so we just got done raving about how it looks great, and then we see...
No, it looks very good. It just, the game itself doesn't seem that interesting.
Well, it takes a very certain kind of person to be into this kind of game anyways. I mean, I'm sure that there's a person out there that is looking at this and saying, man, this looks so cool and so fun. I can't wait to solve a... For no man,
right? So you're saying that there is someone with no taste out there.
I can't wait to solvent.
As a matter of fact, yes, and we probably might want them to join our Discord server for that matter, because if you've got no taste, we want you to join it.
Yeah, then you're our kind of people.
Exactly. And you can do that by looking at the link that has probably just been posted by the Cowbot. Thank you, Cowbot.
Though, I give him a little bit of props for at least, like, I like a good ghost story, you know? So at least they're doing the paranormal and kind of, like, noiring a paranormal story rather than just doing straight noir, you know?
Fair enough. Story. Any last thoughts on this before we move on?
Is this supposed to be a point and click?
Yes.
Looks like it.
It looks like it, yeah. With some animated type stuff in.
More like a click and watch.
I love how the motorcycle scene though, like the motorcycle scene is made to look like it's high action or whatever, like you're controlling this motorcycle that he's riding, but it's two buttons at the top that you click on for left or right.
I kind of like the fact that the bike goes a little too far to one side.
Yep.
Almost like he's riding on the side of the motorcycle.
Yeah.
But anyway, so we're going to move on.
Intense action.
Intense action. For the Wolfe. The next game on the list is, of course, it's Alphabet Soup. It's an MMO MOBA. Okay.
MOBA.
It is called Crush Online, because we haven't heard that before.
Wait, so is this a MOBA or a dating sim?
It's a MOBA.
It's actually a MOBA dating sim. You are dating MOBAs.
I'm a MOBA. I always wanted to take Tabula Rasa out.
All right, yeah. A free to play. So, all right, are you ready to be? Are you ready to hear what this is?
Ready.
FTP PvP MMO with MOBA style combat.
With WAR?
I just vomited a little bit.
Yeah,
How many other acronyms can we cram into the description?
How about exactly. WTF and LMAO?
And LOL WAT. LOL, what?
What?
I actually want that to be a new genre on Steam at this point. Just the LOL what? It probably is a review.
Seriously.
So, but in all honesty, like, what do we have here other than what it looks like the most generic PvP, like, MMO I have ever seen?
It's totally not trying to be League of Legends. It's trying to be its own thing. Don't you judge it.
Unless you're trying to date it.
Yeah.
It's true. No, but that, I'd have to introduce it to you guys first to see if you approve.
That is a tough sell right there. We're protective of you, Kellogg.
Also, do you notice it's available October, like with a K?
That's because it's foreign.
But usually on the English version of Steam, you get to see it in English.
No, it's whatever the developer typed in there.
Hmm.
Like, you'll see fall sometimes, you'll see autumn other times. Sometimes on the release date, you'll see Cyrillic characters.
Well, hey.
I actually prefer my descriptions in Cyrillic. I'd like to be able to play the ARG to figure out what the hell I'm looking at. So, maybe we should actually add that. Maybe it could be an ARG as well.
I mean, I always feel like I understand that people think that, like, MMOs are successful, and obviously they are, and MOBAs are successful. So, I hate that then it goes like, we should just take MOBAs and MMOs and just push them together.
It looks like a watered down version of Diablo almost.
Yeah.
I guess. Yeah.
I mean, Diablo, and then you see the LOL stuff, and then you see the HOTS stuff, and then, yeah. I'm running out of comparisons.
I don't know. Picky.
I bet there's some developers, like somewhere along the line, obviously some discovered the MOBA formula and was obviously very popular, but that was kind of like discovered by accident through like a game map in Warcraft 3. So I bet there's other people out there that are trying like different formulas, hoping they might strike gold on the next big like winning formula. You know, like what is going to be the next MOBA? Like before MOBAs, it was more RTSs, right? And before RTSs, it was more first-person shooters. and now it's MOBAs is like the biggest one. I'm
you know what I think is the problem, though, with people trying to do that? The problem with people trying to do that is that they're focusing on a specific formula, but the type of game takes off because somebody comes up with something different that people think is a lot of fun. You know, and it's about how much fun it is to do this new different thing. If you're just going, okay, well, I want to make a game that's like that, but give it a twist to make it better, then it's like, well, you're still selling the same kind of game, you know, so that's not a significant selling point. You know, like, you got to actually come up with whatever the hell is fun, you know.
No!
And yep. I've seen people pitch a fit about the idea of a MOBA being made that did things a little bit differently than how other MOBAs did it. Like if it just handled the character progression a little differently, they're like, that's not a MOBA! It's like, who fucking cares? It's about what's fun.
Yep. Well, I mean, it's also like, what defines a MOBA is just like, not is like, I feel like it's basically everything to do with the flow of the game, right? Like you're, or yeah, like in like the way you're supposed to be, like kind of, it's like a tug of war on your map, essentially, is what a MOBA kind of is. Yeah. And that's not like a formula that has one way of doing it. Like even when MOBAs were first coming out, you know, the first Dota for Warcraft 3, there was like 30 versions of Dota, or more. Like there's maybe even hundreds of versions of the original Dota for Warcraft 3. So I mean, I'm willing to believe that there's more than one way to do it. I'm just not convinced the right way to do it is to smash it up with an MMO and then make it free to play.
Yeah, what I was going to say is I'm really picky about MOBAs because I'm not a huge fan of them, but I like playing Heroes of the Storm, and I found a few others that I like. And it's kind of the same with like MMOs. I liked World of Warcraft back in the day, but I feel like now there's way too much to the game. I've recently started playing Guild Wars 2. I think it's awesome and really fun, and I like played DDO back in the day. I played Neverwinter.
But we're talking about the MOBA, so we're talking about
This one is supposed to be both, and I don't know. Like, I'm already picky about finding like those two separate genres. I imagine combining the both is just hard.
I feel like it would basically
hard to get out to get people.
I feel like it would basically just be like what the PvP in WoW, where you went in and you had an objective. You take, I don't know, like Warsong Gulch. Clearly, that's what it is, right? I mean, like, if you want to be both, you're just following in the footsteps of somebody else.
That pretty much is all of Greenlight in one shot.
Yeah, that's not necessarily like a bad thing. There's like a good thing with finding inspiration from games you like and trying to take good aspects of games you like and adding it to maybe a game you're making. And then there's that. And then there's also blatantly stealing or just being like, no, I'm just going to take this genre and make a game. You know, it happens a little too often. And kind of a good example of that too is that Wildstar game we played on Free to Play Fridays. That game was made by a bunch of World of Warcraft developers that were like, well, we know how to make a game now. Let's go try it ourselves. And it didn't pan out as well as they had hoped. It was a pretty fun game when we played it, and I enjoyed it. But obviously, it didn't sell the way they intended it to. And that was just another thing of people taking like, well, we know how to do this genre, so we'll do that. But they weren't really inspired by anything.
And again, I think that goes back to you need to be making what is fun. You need to make something that has a reason for people to want to play it. You can't just go, well, this is the same as this thing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, well, and because I feel like it's like what they're trying to do is like a form of like entertainment induction. You know what I mean? They're like forcing all these pieces together because those are the fun things people like. And games, like you said, they're supposed to be creative, and the fun is sort of supposed to sprout outward from the, you know, the artistic, creative intentions of the developers, and what genre it is isn't supposed to be that important, right? I mean, you shouldn't define your game by the genre it's in. Your game should be made because you want to make it that way, and then it fits within a genre.
I would say the way that I would word that would be your game shouldn't be defined by how other people define games.
Right.
Your game should be defined by itself. It should be defined by how it plays.
Yep, by how you make it.
Yep. Should.
What you put into it. Not,
but we have to.
I agree with you, Eli, yeah.
but we have to admit that a lot of developers kind of want to make money. And yeah, we've seen this trapping with AAA developers, and of course we're going to see it with some indie developers. Again, the aforementioned Digital Suicide, as I'm going to jump on the bandwagon of calling them, since that's what they committed.
I like that name. Not a bad bandwagon.
Yeah, just like what they did is they saw what was popular and they did it really, really, really poorly. Let's be honest, a lot of stuff on Greenlight is desperate for views, and they already know, well, hey, if you like Dota, you'll love our game. Or if you like Heroes of the Storm, you'll like our game. Or if you like World of Warcraft, you'll like our game. Or you like Call of Duty and get the fuck off Steam. You know, it really just depends. People are going to gravitate toward the things they like. So we see a lot of these copycats specifically because the people that are voting on Greenlight, for example, are either voting it in because for the lulz, or they're voting it in because they want a new experience, but they want the same experience, which is what makes gamers so maddening when they say we want something original, but not too original, because then we won't buy it.
Yeah, it's just kind of like music, too. And,
it's
and
incredibly like music.
It's like entertainment in general, which kind of stinks, but it's also good because... You know, I've said this a few times, and I'll say it again. Like, the oversaturation of entertainment is a good thing. It sucks for the people making it because it's harder and harder to make money. But right. Like, there's just so many options, and in all of those options, you can like see the stuff that is not as good. And sometimes that is subjective, but a lot of times also it is objective. It's just not that good or wasn't well put together. That it goes like for movies. Music, video games, writing, and the like oversaturation that we see is really great because you weed out some of those bad things and then it like allows for those really, really good nuggets to shine. Nuggets.
Shining nuggets. That phrase. Oh my gosh.
Mm-hmm. Well, we were talking about McNuggets earlier, and then I was thinking about gold, so I met it in the middle there.
It's the standard sequel to Shining Force, of course. That's all it is.
Shining. Do we have a sequel to The Shining?
Yeah, it's called actually, The Shining.
Not
too.
Without Kubrick.
Eli, yeah,
I'll grant you that, Steven. Eli, not without Kubrick.
I actually was in the grocery store the other day, and there is a sequel to The Shining. It's a book.
No.
About
okay,
the
but
kid.
I meant the movie.
It's about a book about the kid from The Shining who grew up and is dealing with having The Shining as an adult.
That's awesome.
It looks really interesting. He's apparently like alcoholic and depressed and trying to deal with the trauma from his childhood.
I think you were probably reading Stephen King's autobiography in that case.
I was thinking about buying it, but I was in a hurry. But yeah, it exists. I can't remember what it's called, but it exists.
Shining 2, Shine On.
I don't know.
I guess that would make sense, though, for it to be Stephen King as the alcoholic that's depressed and can't get over his life, considering he writes the same book over and over and over.
He does, but he's prolific.
He's like one of my favorites. So, guys, careful.
I read Langoliers back when. The only thing I'm going to read from him in the future will be the Dark Tower series because everyone has said it's great.
You need to read that.
One of my favorite things that I ever read was actually a Stephen King short story called The Growing Finger. That story was fucking awesome because it was so weird.
I mean, the one where all the trucks and cars come alive is pretty crazy.
Oh, Maximum Overdrive.
Yeah, that was a funny movie, actually. The movie
Maximum
name,
Overdrive
so ridiculous.
Isn't Stephen King, is it?
You know
it is.
What? The thing about Maximum Overdrive that made it really great was the way that Stephen King talked about it before it came out, where he played it up like it was going to be this thing that showed just how shitty the rest of the movie industry was because they weren't even trying, and then it was just the corniest piece of shit ever.
They weren't even trying.
Yeah.
He was trolling everyone.
Oh my god, that movie stars Emilio Estevez.
Yes.
Yep.
It does.
The truck. Yeah.
It actually lost $1 million.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That happened. At least in the box office.
King looked in his couch cushions, found it, and then it didn't really matter.
Then it didn't matter.
Yeah.
But, okay, but so this game sucks.
Seriously though, I just want to add in there though. I am fairly positive that Stephen King was just trolling everyone with that movie.
Probably, but I still think he was doing more trolling with the Creepshow. Name,
and sorry, I know we need to get back to the trailer, but
we will.
The name of the movie is Maximum Overdrive, but yeah. Stephen King just called his movie Trucks.
That's what it was. It was Trucks.
That's incredible.
It's just Trucks. I mean, it's like a PBS show for kids. Trucks and trains. Like
then some wary super Christian mom rented that movie, and then when did that movie come out? Late 90s?
Oh, this is gonna be great for little Timmy. He loves trucks.
He loves trucks.
Does anybody remember that movie called Christine about the evil car?
Yeah.
Like the car that just hated everyone.
Yeah. That was a good one. Well, it didn't hate everyone. It was super jealous.
Yeah. Oh, it was a great movie.
The car that hated everyone sounds like a good one, too. That's a good one. Carrie, yeah.
Okay, so.
That'd be like the little train engine that could.
Okay, so now that we're done fanboying and girling, maybe we should come back to the game.
I guess we probably should, so.
Dreamy Warrior, are you committing seppuku again? I see your messages are deleted.
No, that was actually Steven because he made a new name.
No, Dreamy Warrior 00 just got three messages deleted in a row.
Yeah, he just did seppuku again.
Oh.
You keep stabbing yourself way too much, Dreamy Warrior.
What? Moobot wouldn't let me perform seppuku.
His mods can't do that.
Ooh, damn it.
He's just knocking everybody down. Moobot's jealous. Damn.
Steven, I need to actually add you into the list for Moobot.
You don't. You actually don't. But no, we're never done fanboying or fangirling for that matter. And I still say that Stephen King was best in the Creepshow movies. But that's me.
Oh, man. Oh, Creepshow movies.
But we're going to move on because what more can you say about the PvP MMO MOBA MMO? We already said MMO. Holy shit, there's too many. F2P, thank you. I knew I was forgetting one of them. Anyway, we're going to move on to the next game on the list. It is, wow, these titles are just getting so...
This is a great list.
They're getting better and better. Yeah.
I feel like this is like a lineup for a metal concert more than game names. Like Butcher, Sentry Knight Tactics, Ballistick, Crush Online.
I gotta be honest, I would totally watch Endless Space Zoo. Yeah. All right.
Endless Space Zoo. nothing but space tigers for miles.
Hey.
Tiger Bob.
Dude, Hyper Gods is cool.
Yeah, right? Ooh. So let's get on to it. Hyper Gods releasing on the 7th of October of this year. Arcade shooter, but it's a 1v1 dog style type shooter. Definitely looks pretty.
I mean, this is a spaceship shooter. Cool.
It looks like Aerial Beyblade, to be honest.
Oh, Beyblade.
Beyblade sounds
Okay, admittedly, I would never have played Beyblade if I didn't have, like, a 7-year-old nephew. And let me tell you, sometimes it gets to the point where I'm like, hey, where's your little Beyblade arena thing? Let's go at this. And he, of course, knows, like, awesome. He knows, like, the right combination of those stupid piece of metal, plastic, and another piece of metal to make it spin faster. And I'm always like, yeah, I'll take this one because it's blue. But it's they're pretty cool. and that's my Beyblade rant.
Okay. That wasn't really a rant.
I'm just looking at this game, and it looks like one of the things you can do is, like, exit your ship. Which is kind of crazy for a game like this. That's, like, not usually something you do. Like, it looks like the astronaut, like, leaves the ship, and, like, things are going around. He's, like, tethered to them with energy tethers or something. Like, it's pretty hard to tell because it's like a... What's that?
It's just the spaceship of the future.
Ah, yes.
You can jump out at any point and just be energized to your ship. Yeah, they're going to make a new word for it. How's that?
Energized? I don't know if I really want to see that word become a thing, but I feel like this needs VR. Chris, what do you think?
We need to start
This looks like the kind of if this was in VR, this looks like exactly the kind of game that would make you sick. and also maybe have a seizure.
You gotta get them ready.
And actually, though, I mean, I would say for VR, this would be about as useful as like reading a graphic novel in VR. two-dimensional games, or I should say, it's not a 2D game, but it's kind of looks flat. And flat games work just fine in VR. It's just that VR doesn't really bring anything to the table.
with that. And also it tends to make the graphics harder to see because it's cramming it onto a screen that's, you know, attached to your face. So I would say probably no on the VR, but I'll try anything once.
The good old college try.
That is right. Sometimes you just don't remember what you tried in college. Eli, any thoughts on this shiny thing? Yeah, this is true.
I don't know. This doesn't really look like my type of game. I was just having fun with the jokes.
Yeah, well, do you have any more jokes?
Not that I can think of off the top of my head, no.
Great.
I have some dirty jokes.
Well, those are the best
ones. Plenty of those going about being an energist.
Yeah. Why are weird tongue-shaped bay blades flying through buckets of ice? This is just, I just don't understand this game. I'm sorry.
You really broke that down there, Caitlin.
That's a pretty good descriptor of it, honestly.
It looks like a really fast game. And this is so hard to tell exactly how it's going to play out. I think until I actually got to sit down and try it.
I think somebody has to have a seizure before they can understand it.
All right, yeah. Well, that's
what
I volunteer.
You want to volunteer to have the seizure? Okay.
Hey, I'm already in VR. I'm probably burning all kinds of brain cells and crossing all kinds of wires, so you might as well make me your guinea pig.
This is entirely true. Well, if you're that eager, I guess we might as well put him to use. Anyway, any other thoughts on this one? We're moving at a pretty fast clip. I mean, they're pretty simplistic. They look fun. Pretty much the whole list has been great so far. Yeah. We've only had one or two.
I think that's the problem, is we're used to seeing games, like, we get more content out of shitting on games.
We don't know what to do when we see games that look good.
that we agree with. Yeah.
I know. I'm used to seeing at least one total piece of shit, and I don't think we've gotten to that.
Wait a minute, I think we just hit it, because it's a Sega game.
Uh-oh.
Don't shit on Sega, even if half their games are shit.
Half
of Nintendo's games are shit. Come on.
Well, actually.
Sega has made some really good games. More than half of PC games
are shit.
Exactly. Sega is technically ahead of the curve.
Yes.
I'm going to give the entire PC gaming industry.
But no, I do have to say, like, I don't know, Sega's made some pretty good games.
In the past 10 years,
I would say. Like, one example, and I bring this up often, is Vanquish for PS3. Incredible shooter. It's so awesome. And they did a really good job with it.
You know what else was really good, which they were actually only a publisher on, but still? Alien Isolation.
Yeah, I have not played it personally, but I've watched it played a lot on Twitch, and I like it.
That's a damn good game.
Well, yeah, so
way better Alien game than anything anybody else ever made.
Not that this happened anytime recently, but Sega did make F-Zero GX, which was an excellent, excellent game.
I'm still trying to get my head wrapped around that one, to be honest with you.
Yeah. But even still, good game's a good game.
Yeah,
this one looks pretty. The graphics in this one look pretty excellent.
They do.
Mm-hmm. Endless Space itself was fun. It does prove that Sega doesn't always screw up a property, so that's always a good sign. As long as there aren't hedgehogs involved, they seem to do really, really well with it. Who knew?
So it says turn-based 4X space strategy.
Yes.
That's awesome. Those are great.
It's not Rob's cup of tea.
No.
Okay. Why is it not your cup of tea?
I don't think 4X games suck. I just don't like playing them. I usually get bored and... Like, I really like tactical games where you kind of... It's more like individualistic, and what I mean by that is it's more like character building and stuff like that. And when it kind of use this game as an example, or let's see, Eve Online. There we go. That's a good one. That game is about like teaming up with like 100 people, controlling territories, getting supplies, and blah 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 blah. And I'm like, nah, I'd rather get a magic sword and figure out how to get Fire 3.
Well, I definitely think it looks cool.
I think it looks cool and everything. I just don't play. I'm not good at the games either. Every time I try, like the only technical 4X game that I play that I enjoy is XCOM. And that's a little lighter. Yeah. The newest two XCOMs are definitely like four. They're not. Oh man. they are 4X games, but they touch on the lighter side of them. But even still, I'm using those as an example because those are just like a little bit beyond my like complication level.
Well, and the truth is for 4X games, and this isn't always true because it really depends, and I'm sure style, you know, Eli's got a lot to say on this, but I always felt that especially in the earlier ones, but even some modern ones like Elite Dangerous, the payoff for fun doesn't tend to come always like for a little while. Sometimes you do have to be willing to put in a little bit of work, and I think it's really dependent on your personality, whether or not that feels like work or that feels like you're actually participating in like basically an alternate reality. And so I think it just comes down to what kind of imagination it, you know, your what your gaming imagination is like. I think that some people really enjoy like being lost in really cool expansive fantasy worlds, which is why like, you know, World of Warcraft and Oblivion and those types of games are super popular. But then other people I think really like the idea of participating, you know, for whatever reason, in a more realistic interpretation of a fantasy world, but in a crazy setting, like outer space.
Yeah, and I also think that a lot of people really like getting down to, like, the finite aspects of things, too. And I feel like 4X games cover that a lot, because sometimes it goes from, like, army to squadron to, you know, company to individual private, and then, like, and it, like, you can kind of narrow it down further and further and further for a lot of those games. And I feel like a lot of people like having those really finite options, which is not a bad thing at all. Actually, at all. It just improves the gameplay. Technically, I suppose I like more simple games in a sense.
Well, and I think, and it's also
this,
you know,
game, though, in all honesty, looks beautiful. Like that's,
they tend not to involve a lot of action, you know? That's the fundamental issue I have.
Oh, gotcha.
Yeah. There's just a lot of waiting around in these types of games.
Yeah, because it also depends, because there's games, I don't know, like, my girlfriend's a huge fan of, like, the Harvest Moon games, and she plays Stardew Valley for Torchfork Mob, and I think those games are fun, but I'm awful at them. I just, for some reason, it makes me think, like, wow, if, like, the world ended, there'd be no way I'm going to, like, start a farm. I don't even understand what I'm doing in a game. How am I supposed to do it?
Yeah.
And stuff, like, but it kind of just goes to show that there's kind of, one, there's games for everybody, and two, they're, you can learn to appreciate the game style and the genre without actually liking it yourself.
But on the plus side, if you're ever tasked to go find 4 orbs of the elements, you should be totally sad.
Yeah, I'd be pretty happy.
Yep.
Be like, what? I only get.
Although he might have trouble finding food along the way.
No, I eat every stream.
You haven't mentioned
I'm talking about if you hit the end of the world and you need to go find those orbs. You know, if you don't have somebody there to provide you with the food.
Step
you
one,
might have
Eli.
A problem.
Step one, Eli. Find where the Twinkies are. Step two, live off of Twinkies for 6 years.
I can't argue with that.
I will grant you that. I will grant you that. But that is also entirely dependent on you finding the Twinkie supply.
That's dependent on me finding where Twinkies could be.
Yeah. And in sufficient quantity to last that long.
I need a factory size amount of Twinkies. I need to find them immediately. In a bunker to hide myself from people so they don't steal my Twinkies.
You know, for a second there, I thought you said a plunger, which also would have been accurate considering the massive amount of Twinkie ingestion. So.
Yeah, man. You need a plunger.
Oh, that's awesome, Stylo. I was going to say, too, like, man, remember, didn't they take Twinkies away, like, a couple years ago?
They did, and they found
out
that...
They almost went out of business.
Yeah.
Oh, that's what it was.
Yeah. And I don't know what happened, because when I was driving to Boston, I saw a little Debbie truck, so they seem to be doing okay, whatever company that is. But
you know, honestly, the way it played out, it sounded like it was mostly just they didn't want to pay their workers more, so they decided to go out of business and then come back and rehire everyone for less.
Yep.
So really?
Everybody's an indentured servant contractor to the Twinkie Empire.
I always now I have to eat my Twinkies with guilt. Thanks, Eli.
Yep. It's still made.
To be fair, that is the best way to eat a Twinkie is with guilt.
I eat Twinkies because of my guilt.
It's still made.
Well, now there's going to be more to justify it.
They're still made by whatchamacallit, Hostess. And yeah, pretty much that. They went out of business and were like,
whatchamacallit was made by Hershey.
We're gonna stop selling them. Then pretty much like a year later, they're like, just kidding.
Yeah, because then everybody started buying them in bulk and hoarding them and selling them on eBay, which was great.
Talking about the Twinkie Panic?
Yeah.
Yep.
Twinkie Panic, is that what it's known as? Really?
In my head.
Yeah. In your head, okay.
Yeah, and the CEO himself claimed to bankruptcy, not Hostess.
Oh. I was going to say, I don't think Hostess could ever go bankrupt.
Because, no, they probably not. They're too big. But Hostess specifically requested to shut down the Twinkie production themselves.
Too big to fit through the door, more like. But
then, so literally in six months later, they were making Twinkies again.
So can I just say, we have managed to get even farther off topic with this game.
Twinkies
are important.
Yeah. Well, not only that, we have like half an hour to fill, and there's only one game left. So
Twinkies are the Tang in this game. I mean, we have to talk about stuff that would survive, stuff that would survive in space, right? I think Twinkies.
Cockroaches.
That's right, cockroaches.
Okay. And water bears. Water bears survive out there.
I'm also just noticing that there was a first endless space.
The title is Endless Space 2.
They were just calling it 2 for
hey,
fun.
Hey, that happens.
Really.
Don't act like it doesn't.
When has that ever happened?
Final Fantasy, Secret of Mana's. Do you want more examples? that has happened.
One example. Well, just because we can't number stuff in the States doesn't necessarily mean anything.
One thing I do like is and I don't know why I look at system requirements as often as I do, but the system requirements of this one are really specific.
Okay.
Which I think is pretty funny. Like, down to the resolution you should put your monitor at.
And down to
the generation of processor you should have.
Well, the generation of processor makes sense because different processor generations get different instruction sets.
I get the fundamental reasons why. It's just so rarely does anyone bother, you know?
Yeah.
Well, it's Sega, so there's that. Well, recommended or the minimum? Which do you want?
You know what I really want them to make?
What Kellogg was
I want them to make a good Outlaw Star game. How cool would that be? That's what I want.
It'd be just cool to see an Outlaw Star game, period.
Yeah.
What about a Cowboy Bebop game? That'd be awesome.
It would, but that show's so good, and I don't know.
You don't want them to accidentally ruin it?
Well, it's because they easily could. That's just kind of it. Whereas, like, Outlaw Star, I feel like, would be a lot easier to make into a game. Personally, I may be wrong.
Without screwing it up? Really?
No, I think just like the scenes that are in I don't know. I guess you could totally do it in Cowboy Bebop too. I was just thinking of like basically what I was thinking of is the mass amount of people that get killed by Gene Starwind / Spike. I'm like, well, not. No, no, he kills a lot of people. Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Fair enough. But anyway, Kellogg, do you want to read these specs? Since portion of the show.
Sure, because apparently that's what it's come to now.
Yep.
But the thing that I did find interesting is that it specifically called out an i3 fifth generation or newer, or an i5 third generation or newer, or this particular FX chip or newer. And it was kind of just funny to me that they would literally specify like the architecture. But you know, maybe that shouldn't surprise me because the kind of person that wants to play this kind of game wants to know that shit, you know? And the kind of person that's going to make this game is probably going to put that shit out there.
Yeah.
And, you know, it does say, you know, that the other one has won a bunch of awards. So, I'm inclined to believe that this is going to be a good game.
Also, Rob, thank you for the Twinkie Linky.
Yep.
The Twinkie Linky.
Where's the Twinkie Linky?
Oh, man.
I guess we might as well move on to the final game of the evening before we get some...
Twinkie Wiener Sandwich.
Because of course there is.
What?
Well, look, if you can deep fry a Twinkie, why can't you have a Twinkie wiener sandwich?
I mean, yeah, have you ever had like an Elvis sandwich? You know, like piece of toast, peanut butter, banana, and bacon with a little bit of honey on it.
Oh, that sounds pretty good.
And Elvis Quaaludes. Sandwich. Don't forget the Quaaludes. And you gotta have those in there too. And
Quaaludes.
I could make a Russian Quaalude real quick.
But what's it called? Yeah, Elvis sandwiches are delicious.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
God, I really want Twinkie now.
Peanut butter, bacon, banana, and honey.
So we are going to start that Cooking with Torchfork show at some point, I'm sure.
Oh, yeah, you know, there's
and
also...
It's all going to be state fair foods where everything is deep fried.
I know. I also just remembered another one. Elvis used to make this thing called hangover gravy. I kid you not. It was... I didn't meet him personally because...
It was whiskey,
you know, really.
Wasn't it?
No, it was coffee and bacon grease.
That sounds healthy as hell.
Yeah, and he would put it on food. Yeah, Corey died of fat death. He was a slob. He was a slob in the end. Terrible dude.
Stylo, deep fried butter. That I think is the state food of Texas.
Deep fried butter. I'd try that.
How can you deep fry butter?
You just throw it in a fryer later.
So what you do is you roll it, like you dip it in batter, and then you throw it in the fryer. And what it does is it like cooks the batter and melts the butter inside. So it's just butter-filled batter.
Oh, okay. That sounds amazing. Yep.
Yeah.
I mean, it'd be like heart-stopping, but...
Yeah, and you can like sprinkle it with like marinara sauce or, you know, powdered sugar.
Did you say that with an accent?
I did.
Okay. I didn't hear that incorrectly.
Did you know that the Twinkie became known worldwide in countries which did not sell it, thanks to a reference from Ghostbusters?
Oh, that's great.
Well, I don't Ghostbusters, know. Tell us about the Twinkie.
So it's it says Egon is describing a speculated level of psychokinetic energy and uses
yeah,
a regular
uses a Twinkie
size to represent the normal level of such energy. And then he says that based on a recent sample, the Twinkie representing New York would be over 35 feet long and weigh approximately 600 pounds. To which the character Winston replies with the famous line, "That's a big Twinkie."
Yeah.
And then we sold them outside of America.
Yeah, I guess we're just going to do cultural night tonight. That's apparently what tonight
yeah,
is.
Yeah, I know.
Why not? I ask you, why not? No, seriously.
So,
why?
Yeah.
No more
anyone anyone else checking out this Shadow Warrior trailer?
I'm about to because I'm really eager to see Shadow Warrior, but I'm not going to say it because every game I've wanted to see this year has sucked ass. But that being said.
We'll just ignore what you just said.
Exactly. Shadow Warrior 2! About freaking time. I was a big fan of the original Shadow Warrior, and then the remake of Shadow Warrior, and then holy crap, Shadow Warrior 2. With the, hopefully, the updated version of the Viscera Cleanup Crew game, which was always fun. But if you...
Viscera?
Yeah, whoa, that's pretty much it, yeah. If you ever wanted to be in a Tarantino film, this is your chance.
Pretty much.
Yeah.
So I've seen I've never played the original Shadow Warrior, but I know it's legendary, and every movie I've seen made it look awesome.
Yes.
Okay. Shadow Warrior, the original, the great thing about it was that it was so brazenly offensive and just did not give a shit.
It was the Asian equivalent of Duke Nukem if Duke Nukem actually had balls. That's pretty much the nicest way to put it.
The game still goes for $40 on Steam. Oh, that was only 2 years ago it was released, though. Okay.
Well, that'll be the remake.
Yeah.
Okay.
The original one was basically...
Came out in, like, 96?
Yeah, 97. Correct me if I'm wrong. Wasn't that basically on the same engine as Duke Nukem?
It was. It was the same engine. It was the build engine, I believe, that was used for Duke Nukem 3D. They just decided to do a Japanese-themed Duke Nukem 3D, and... The main character, even though he's supposed to be Japanese, supposed to be some kind of ninja, his name was Lo Wang.
Lo Wang.
Lo Wang.
Awesome.
And there were so many really obviously racist jokes in there.
Incredibly fucking racist. There's no other way to put it.
Yeah, it was racist as hell, but in a way that it wasn't really like insulting Asian people or anything. It was just like, wow, All right.
So back in the 90s where we just didn't care.
Yeah.
So I'm looking at Shadow Warrior Classic, which is also available on Steam. I'll put that link in. And I guess when I look at the HD remake, really seem like it's even remotely the same game.
Well, no. The newer version that got released a couple of years ago was by an entirely new studio. It wasn't just remaking the same old game. It was like a complete reimagining of it, where they took the Lo Wang character and gave him an entirely different storyline, and they changed the whole look and feel of it. They made him younger.
It made him more like Jet Li, basically.
What? Yeah.
The original Shadow Warrior's free.
Yeah.
Yeah. The original, probably.
In the original, he was older. He had like a really gravelly voice. And he was like, they took plenty of opportunities to make it abundantly clear he was an outright perv in the original. Yes. Like randomly strewn about naked anime girls. He like walks up to one who's taking a bath in a waterfall, and if you hit the space bar on her, he'd be like, oh, Lo Wang drops soap. You bend over, pick it up now.
Hopefully you'll find Stylo,
I love that game.
I beg of you, if you don't clip any other bit from this show, please God clip that so that we can rerun it all the time.
Yeah.
I really think we just have to have Eli say all the dialogue from the original Shadow Warrior. I would be okay with that.
Just in one long cut.
Yeah, just one long super cut. But yeah, I believe, if I remember, Sailor Moon was in one of the hidden areas.
Oh, Eli? Really?
Yeah, they...
I don't remember Sailor Moon being in there. I just know there were a lot of anime girls in it, and a lot of times they were naked.
Yeah, I mean, if you just look it up on the community page for Steam, God help you if you go look at it. But you'll find a whole bunch of them for Shadow Warrior Classic. There's even a little in-joke Easter egg about Tomb Raider. She's hung up. All the old Duke Nukem games, they always had little Easter eggs.
Like, yeah, you could get the girl to like flash you at the strip club in Duke Nukem. Sure.
Oh yeah, that didn't really happen in Shadow Warrior. Like, they weren't flashing you. In fact, like the naked anime girl in the waterfall, if you kept hitting spacebar on her, she would shoot you with an Uzi.
As you do, you know, that's just how that works. But yeah, it is true. The original game and the remake or the reimagining are kind of distant. Like, you get some basics about it, but I enjoyed the hell out of the remake, but I also loved the original game on floppies. So, there's that.
Terrific.
Dude, the way he reloads the shotgun in Shadow Warrior 2 is crazy. He literally flips the bullet. Yeah, he just flips the gun around, throws the bullets in the air, and they land in the chamber.
There are people that actually do that.
Yep.
What?
I really liked
that. Like, seriously, YouTube channel called Demolition Ranch. The guy on that channel, one of the things that he's done for fun on his videos is he would actually like set the shotgun shells on the shotgun, knock them up into the air, catch them in the chamber, lock it, and then shoot the gun.
I was gonna say in Resident Evil 4 too, when you get the broken butterfly, the first magnum, how Leon refills it is emptying the chamber behind his shoulder, then redoing it, and I remember seeing that for the first time when I played that game and just being like, wow, if I ever have a gun like that, that's the only way I'll reload it.
Ever.
Yeah,
it does make you feel like a total badass.
Yeah, it does.
And that's really what the game is all about.
Isn't that the point of being a gamer at all?
Yeah, I mean, to a point, but it's really, really clear.
Fast-paced, skill-based Carnage.
Gordon. Yeah, this is a Twitch shooter by itself. I mean, it's all about fast action, fast reaction. You feel like a total badass. You feel like you're in a Robert Rodriguez film if Robert Rodriguez had yet another bender with Quentin Tarantino. I think he's got another one scheduled, like, in an hour. So, you know, this is that kind of game.
I wouldn't exactly call it a Twitch shooter, though, because it's not super fast-paced.
Some of the areas you can get mobbed pretty quick, though.
Yeah, but I mean, in Twitch shooters, generally, you know, you'll have enemies coming at you where you'll have a split second to react to them. But with this, it's a little bit slower pace than that. Like, generally, you know, you have a moment to figure out what you want to do. At times, it does get pretty hectic, but it's not dependent on the idea of you having Twitch reflexes to hit them. You can move around and take your time and aim.
Yeah. And, of course, there are some aspects to it that are kind of... I hate to keep throwing it back, but kind of like Dishonored. You get some powers. I think one of them, you can heal yourself. Another one slows down time. The standard stuff. I don't know anything about the new game because I'm trying to not know anything about it. But obviously, watching the trailer, kind of have no choice now. But
the biggest thing I think is a big deal about this one is the fact that obviously it's co-op. You get multiple people in doing all the stuff at once.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah, that is cool. Yeah, I also like the motion looks cool. Like you can like jet left and jet right and jet backwards really easy. Like I'm imagining you're doing like a double tap to do backwards real quick and double forward to go forward. And then when you like jump off of a building, you do a roll and the camera rolls with you, which is pretty. That's like it's a little disorienting but pretty cool. I feel like this in many ways is a more pure first-person experience. It like really, like even when you're running up a ladder, you're much more in like first-person than you are like even in a lot of other games, even like Half-Life.
It also reminds me of like the new Doom 2, which I loved and think is amazing, because it kind of has that same kind of flow in battle that I can see here that the new Doom definitely had and did very well on.
Yeah.
Plus, like, this just looks awesome. Like, it looks like you just dive into the game and you're just immediately killing creatures and, like, titans and stuff. And that just looks awesome to me. Plus, in my opinion, like, any two-player game in this style already, like, gets a plus one for me.
Yeah, this is one of those...
Because co-op is just so fun.
One of those games where it is basically the ultimate... Well, maybe it's a little much, but the ultimate... almost stereotype. Like, if you see a movie where they want to highlight a super violent game, it's probably gonna be this one. Like, this is the combination of all the stereotypes, all the tropes, but it's done in such a fun way that you just can't not enjoy it. Or at least that's been my experience. So if you haven't played it, definitely should.
And I love this trend in, like, just like Doom, I love this trend in first-person shooters now to, like, really give the player as much freedom, like, physically as possible, you know what I mean? And to actually sort of hone the experience into a lot of really, like, tight action, like, segments, where every segment's a little different and feels like when you're, like, in Doom, when you're moving from room to room to room, each moment is kind of, or, you know, each room has got its own little experience, and it sort of offers a certain kind of action, and it's, I feel like this has got that same kind of pacing, which is really awesome.
Mm-hmm.
Most definitely.
Yeah, and like the creatures are kind of frightening. All the sword play looks really fun. I like that you get kind of a huge array of guns that you can unrealistically hold and stuff like that. It's just fun.
What are you talking about unrealistically hold? That's totally how you reload guns. What's your
And plan? That is exactly how you would be holding a minigun and having it fire without any
or some of sort course. Of single shot 50mm.
You don't snipe with a grenade cannon? Why not?
I mean, depending on what I'm doing and where I am.
Okay.
There's a time and a place. There's a time and a place for everything, Steven.
I totally understand that. And
I love the bow and arrow. Like, I know that's another kind of weird, trendy thing in first-person shooters right now. But I'm glad that they just threw it in there with the swords and the grenade launchers and the like and everything else. And, like, you know, the Wolverine claws. They've got everything. It's wild. And when you look at the weapon selection menu, there's like 25 weapons.
Yep.
Well, there's a lot. I would say the bow and arrow thing actually is something that makes sense for this game. So it's supposed to be sort of Japanese themed, and like they've got katanas in there. They're throwing stars and a bunch of other stuff.
Look at that Japanese-themed minigun, Eli. Come on. I mean, really.
Okay, obviously totally it has stuff in there that isn't Japanese-themed, but you're running around on top of Japanese-style buildings and shit.
No, I'm just kidding. Like, I you're right. The main purpose of the game is supposed to be that, though.
The minigun? The minigun's the main purpose.
More Japanesey thing. Japanesey. Yeah. Mac and cheesy.
Like, even in the original game, though, like they had the katana, they had shurikens, they had a bunch of other stuff like that. So it makes sense that it would be here.
Any other thoughts? Any thoughts at all?
I like other I than like this bows. Is,
you like bows? Like frilly bows or just stabby at a distance bows? What kind of
bows and fletchings.
I prefer ties, but that's just me.
What about bow ties? First person Wolverine mode ain't bad.
What's that?
First person Wolverine mode ain't bad.
First person Wolverine mode is what we all live for, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, most of us.
Low Wang. It really is. Low they wing. Do not give a shit. It's awesome. Do you see down here, if you pre-order, you can receive the Razorback, which is a chainsaw katana.
Yeah, I need that.
What?
Yeah.
Yeah,
it's a chainsaw katana. That's hilarious.
Totally historically accurate depiction of katana blades.
Really? Yep. How has no one else ever included that?
Well, amazing. Guess what?
I've seen some like I've seen some games do like a chainsaw like sword kind of thing, but not some. This is like a very literal translation.
I can think of like three examples, but it sounds like. This is going to be more literal.
Yeah, because that looks like something you might actually see at like Home Depot bin.
Yeah.
See, but I mean, Home Depot are you going to?
The one where
the one in Shanghai, dude.
The one where they make God Eater swords.
Oh, okay, that's fair.
Well, the next thing they need to do is they need to add in a chainsaw katana, or katana chainsaw, was what I was thinking. Katana chainsaw, so that it's a chainsaw that's got little katana sticking out of the chain.
Well, technically, it's there got a go. Katana that has the chainsaw sticking out of the blade, so you've kind of got your peanut butter and chocolate right there.
No, but I'm saying it needs to be a single chainsaw that you hold that it has individual katanas sticking up out of the chain.
They just need to bring in the gun blades in Final Fantasy VIII.
No, because I still don't really understand how the hell the gun blade worked. Other
it
than...
shoots through the gun blade.
The barrel goes to nothing.
You know,
Squall's
face got cut by it. Gun blade.
Squall's face got cut because he didn't defend himself in the cutscene.
Yeah,
he does. Whatever.
I'm actually Googling gun blade.
Are you?
Want to know how it works.
maybe when you get to Final Fantasy VIII, you can actually explain to us in detail.
Not play that one.
Really? Are you that against it?
No, I'm not like against it. I just don't care enough to play it, and I like 7 and 9 more.
That sounds
but
like
who knows?
Kind of against it.
I may get to it.
So that's an overwhelmingly meh opinion of 8. I liked 8.
I just want to note that
I googled chainsaw sword, I also got a chainsaw axe, which is fucking awesome.
Whoa!
You probably also got added to at least 2 watch lists and at least 1 mailing list for whiskey.
Yeah, true. I also posted a link in chat of someone who actually attempted to make a chainsaw sword.
Yay! Oh,
really?
I need to find this person and see if they sell them.
It doesn't look very good.
No, it doesn't. It's just a chainsaw with a crap handle added on.
I don't even think that's a chainsaw. That's just a hedge trimmer.
No, that's an electric chainsaw.
Like I said, a hedge trimmer.
They just replaced the handle with a shitty one.
Yeah.
To be fair, our original mock-up for Torchfork was not that brilliant either, guys.
Yes, it was. You be quiet.
It was better than that. At least our original logo didn't say Black & Decker on the side.
Yeah. But Black & Decker is a seal of quality, at least then.
No. It's definitely a seal of made in China.
It's a seal of Sears, perhaps. But anyway, let's go through the usual badly done pitches. Kellogg, if you will, you have a thing that you do. Actually, you and Rob both do.
I do. I'm gonna do my best to try to stream tomorrow, but I don't know if I'll make it because I gotta work on my apartment that I'm moving into.
Right.
So I'll keep you all posted on that. But I do know tomorrow's Retrohaven, right, Rob?
Ah.
Good, good. You're going, I believe you're, I am so out of touch with things, Steven. You could not have picked a worse individual to do the plugs right
that
now.
That is exactly why I picked you, though. That's
tomorrow is going to be retro.
I'm going to go to our website and look at the calendar and then read it to you all.
Hey, it's going to be where is that website there, Chris?
That website may be found at www.torchforkmob.com. And while you're at it, please visit our YouTube. Give us a like. Go on Twitch where you're looking at us right now and see below and give us a follow if you already haven't. Please follow us on Twitter. Please follow us on Facebook. Please follow us on Instagram. We're on all three of them. You can find those on our website as well. And if you love us, Kim, come back next year. We're here every next year. Next week. Year. We're here every Tuesday. We're doing this once
Go
a year.
Go away for folks. A couple months.
We're going to make it with our once a year show. Come again next Tuesday. This is basically where we get to, have a bunch of drinks. We talk about the meat of the industry. So, thank you all for being here. I'm going to pass it off to Rob.
I just felt like
I have a much shorter bump than that.
He hasn't said his bump in so long. He just had to get it all out.
You got
to
refine that shit, yo.
Warrior had a point. The follow button is now above the stream and to the right.
That's right.
Oh, yeah.
That's the layout change.
But that's right, tomorrow, I left Nashville. Twitch looks different.
That's right. Tomorrow we'll have Retro Haven from 11 to 2 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, and then we're going to have Jody's World from 6 to 9 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, which is, 9 to midnight East Coast time?
They can do the math.
East Coast time? But yeah.
Fair enough. And then, of course, Caitlin is going to keep doing her stream every 24 hours or so.
Yeah.
She's just going to keep doing
Thursday. Thursday, there will be something. It will probably be Mario Kart, but it may also be Monster Hunter. I don't have to stream the same thing for 8 hours. I can stream different things over 8 hours.
But now you have to redo the Shadow Temple.
No. I have the clips that Dreamy Warrior made as mementos. I don't need anything.
We'll
else.
Just remake. We'll
she
have
says
you redo
this
the
now.
Shadow. We'll have you redo the Shadow Temple with a timer. How's that?
Oh God, no!
But she says this now. But what's gonna happen is when she picks up that DS again, her save is gone.
Oh,
luckily, it doesn't happen too often.
The hackers
with DS
have returned. Ugh.
Well,
and then we then have the game show.
Show.
Did you want me to keep announcing shows? I will.
Yeah, damn well.
We have so many now that it's better to tell them to just go check out our website because that's where the schedule is.
Where is that website again?
At torchforkmob.com. But we do need to update it a little bit to add the new shows on there. So, Jody's World, the game show tomorrow night. Friday, we're going to have Free to Play Friday.
Tomorrow night. Game show is Thursday night.
Thursday night, excuse me.
This is still Tuesday, Kelly.
It would be much easier to tell the people what we aren't streaming because we're streaming so much.
We're not streaming Puzzle Pirates ever.
Yes.
Snow Horse for 6 hours.
No, we are streaming Snow Horse for 6 hours.
No, so going back though, tomorrow we have another episode of Retro Haven at Jody's World. Thursday we have the game show. Friday we have Retro Haven. Jody's World, Free to Play Friday. Friday's a huge day for our streaming. Saturday, we have Man Bear. I just call it, for right now, Man Bear throws the pigskin. Because he's been playing NFL Blitz.
That hurts.
Well, he does that on Mondays.
Oh, that is Monday?
Yeah.
Either way.
Eli and I will be snowboarding at some point, correct?
There we go.
That's what I'm expecting.
Saturdays is also going to be probably next week. Not this coming Saturday, but the one after.
Yeah, I think you're going to have to, you might have to do the first show or two on your own because it doesn't look like I'm getting to my apartment for maybe as long as 2 weeks. I hate to say it. And my Saturn is very much buried in a box.
That's okay.
I know. I apologize to all the fans that I'm sure were eagerly awaiting for my next show after last time I beat Super Metroid.
Chris, we didn't even know if you were still alive, to be honest with us, so we just kind of took you off the calendar. It's okay.
Oh, yeah. Hey.
We moved on already.
Yeah. I mean, Kelly's just a decent stand-in for Kellogg, let's be honest. He even looks like him. Has the same glasses and everything.
Kinda. Oh, okay.
Similar spelling on the last name, too.
It's really, really not even remotely close.
Yeah, I mean, I've always said that Rob is just another version of me from a different dimension.
Yep.
You want to expand on
that? Well, I was about to say, I was about to say, like, yeah, our girlfriend's names are the same, and then I was like, wait, no.
It is kind of weird.
That's why I went silent.
I like to know exactly how awkward we can end these shows, and wow, Kelly, you got the crown, man.
You did a good job there.
Thank you.
So that being said, in case you couldn't catch any of that drunken reverie, or maybe you're drunk yourself, that's okay. Just go to torchforkmob.com. Of course, you can also follow us on the Twitters. You can like us on the Facebooks. You can follow us on the Instagrammers. You can subscribe to us on the YouTubes. You can throw us money if you want for chocolate and or assorted stuffs. But that is the show for tonight. Check out. We need to buy fanny packs.
Yeah, well, that's the only way to hold and distribute chocolate
correctly. There's also more stuff to do.
We also are going to look into start killing people one every show. So join the Discord channel, and you too can possibly be one of the lucky few that get chosen for Seppuku. So that is the show. Good night, everybody. Go to sleep. Do whatever. Play games. Goodbye.